the loaves beside the sea. Beyond the sacred page, I seek thee, Lord. My spirit longs for thee, O living Word. Bless thou the truth, dear Lord, to me, to me. As thou didst bless the bread by Galilee, then shall all bondage cease, all fetters fall, and I shall find my peace, my all in message written clear and plain for me. Then in sweet fellowship, walking with thee, thine image on my life engraved will.
Going into the community to know their needs, to work with them, to work with their ideas. We ask them, what is your opinion? What is your thoughts? So we are working according to their acceptation. It's my passion and zeal to work for Christ. I have seen and learned the sacrifice of Christ who died for us, and He gave us that much grace, and that's why I decided to be a pioneer, to be a His worker. And this is the place where work was not completed. The Adventist message was not started, so I decided to come to this area, because that time there is no one is there who can teach about the three angel masses. When I see the need of this city, I decided to start working. Just to mingle with them, make friendship with them. We have invited them for dinner and all. So likewise, we have make circle, friend. When people, they're seeing all these communities work, they want to appreciate us. They want to join with us. They want to shake hands with us. We have decided to work for these people. And now we have gathering with the people. So this center of influence we have tried from long time. Lord give us a place. So finally we receive this residence. People are coming from villages to this place to get the knowledge, to religious knowledges for the basic information. So this place is actually is a center of influence for many people who are staying nearby this city. So when we work it, we work only for the Lord, not for the money, not for other things. So people, they have seen the genuine and love, the genuity and the faithfulness of Christ. So that's why they like it. When they like it, then they like the teaching also. We are teaching and touching the lives of many people. I have seen that it's not me or my work or my own strength. It's the Holy Spirit, it's the God who are working in behind and front of us. So I feel much excited and happy. And I want to thank God. He is still leading me.
Good morning and welcome to Adult Sabbath School Bible Study. This week we get to focus on the church and education. When we graduate from junior high, high school, college, from our graduate programs, PhDs even, our education doesn't stop there. We keep learning and growing. Through the internet, we have so much access to resources, publications, and knowledge in different forms in this world today. Other schools or other places offer different kinds of education. We hear about TED Talks, we hear about symposiums, seminars that help us keep growing and learning. There's tons of books out there that help us learn how to grow in different areas of our life, from finances to family, from spirituality to sports and health. But have you considered that we as a church can be a place where people can grow and be educated? Yes, in the Word of God. Yes, in service. And we can grow in our relationships to one another and in our thoughts and in our mind. God wants to develop us, mind, body, and spirit. And the church has its place in society to be able to do that. So as we dive into our study today, I pray that you and I will be blessed to see the role of the church in continuing education in the lives of men and women in our community. Let us pray. God, as we open up your word, as we turn our thoughts towards you and towards your church, the people, and our role with education in our society, I pray that you will open up possibilities for us for your honor and glory and for the blessing and salvation of others. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's go to our memory verse today to set the tone for our time together. It's found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, and it reads like this. Nor did we seek glory from men, either from you or from others, when we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, just as a nursing mother cherishes her own children. So, affectionately longing for you, we were well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you had become dear to us. You can hear the care of the Apostle Paul in his words to the believers in Thessalonica. You can hear how he longs for them. He uses words longing. He's using words that please, it's well pleasing to us. And he says, you have become dear to us. The education of the gospel in the lives of others is best experienced in relationship. Why? Because God is in relationship for all eternity. Him, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. The angels were created, yes, but they've had a chance to relate to each other and socialize for eons. And we were created in God's image. We are created to socialize, to learn, to grow together. God even calls us to share the good news with others from person to person. So what are some key principles that we can learn from our study this week about relationships and education of the gospel? Well, there are many out there, and I know you have some, so I'm going to offer two from my study this week of our time on this topic. The two are courage and compassion. Courage. You know, it takes courage to create the kind of place in church, meaning among our people, where people can ask the really tough questions. There are a lot of people with sincere questions in their heart about God. How do we know God exists? How does He speak to me today in my world? How do I know His will? If God is so good, why does He allow people to suffer in such bad circumstances? Where's God when? And you can fill in the blank. Sometimes we avoid tough questions for different reasons. Sometimes we're afraid that people might ask a question that we don't have an answer to. When I was a student missionary, in the Marshall Islands from 1993 to 1994, one of the things that I learned, a skill that I've been developing ever since that time in the classroom on that island in the Pacific Ocean, is a very simple skill that has been such a blessing. It's taken such a load off my shoulders. It's just brought me so much peace. When someone asks me a question, a difficult question, a challenging question that I might not have an answer to, or it might be a half-formulated answer, I've learned to say, you know, it's a great question. I don't know how to answer it. I don't know are three words that are such a blessing. It's an honest statement. I don't have to be the answer man. You don't have to be the answer woman. We don't always have to have the answers. It does feel good when we do have an answer, doesn't it? When people come to us and they have a question and we're able to help them with knowledge or experience or applying wisdom to their situation. But we don't have to carry the burden of always knowing what to say and how to say it. Sometimes a simple, I don't know, but I'm going to get back to you on that, is an honest, caring question that we can, or answer we can give to people who have tough questions. Our church can be such a place if we exercise courage and take risks to create an environment in small groups or studies that we have with people, that people can ask the very tough questions and explore the answer. You know, some people are afraid that they might lose their faith. But I believe in true Christian education that we as a church have a unique place to help people wrestle with their questions and bring them to us and to the Bible, really, and to Jesus Christ. And there we study the Word of God. Sincere questions, especially the tough ones, will drive us into the Word of God to know God's heart, to know His mind, and to know how to share Him with other people as well. So let's exercise courage. We may not have the answer, and that's okay. Sometimes we're afraid to allow people to ask the tough questions or not create the space or not encourage it because we're afraid what they're going to ask. Some of those things can be difficult, scary, embarrassing. You know, some people might feel like they may be shaken to the core of their foundation of faith. But I believe that courage helps us move forward in the face of fear and risks what the unknown might be. This is the exciting adventure of the spiritual life, where we get a chance to grow with people and to meet them where they're at, just as others have met us where we were at. And for sure, Jesus meets each one of us where we are, even with our tough questions. So for us to be a church that brings in true Christian education, we must create space for people to ask difficult questions and have these challenging discussions so that we might grow from them, learn from them, and let God use them to bring us closer to Himself while deepening our faith. The second thing that will be a blessing to us as a church with education in society is our compassion. You know, Jesus has experienced compassion in many different ways. One time He was looking at the large crowd, and they had been with Him all day, and He was teaching, and they were eating up His words, but He knew that they were hungry because they had not eaten all day. And the Bible says he felt compassion for them as they looked to him like sheep without a shepherd. Compassion. Compassion for us can be summed up in this quote from our lesson study on Sunday. It says this: true Christian education helps us see others as Christ sees them, beings for whom he died, beings whose sins he bore on the cross, beings for whom he paid an infinite price. The parable of the Good Samaritan found in Luke chapter 10 verses 30 through 37 is a great example of the kind of compassion Jesus wants to inculcate in us and for us to live out in the lives of others that we meet each day. In the story of the Good Samaritan, a man was coming down from Jerusalem and he fell among robbers and thieves. They took his wealth, they took his clothes, they beat him and whatever he had and left him to die half dead. A Pharisee walks by on the other side of the road, not wanting to come near the man because he didn't want to touch a man who was bleeding or beaten, and who knows if the other criminals were still around. A priest walks down from Jerusalem and passes the man in the same manner. Odds are the man who was beaten was a fellow Jew, just like them, worshiping in Jerusalem or conducting business there. But it was a Samaritan that came by, saw this man, saw him beaten, bloodied, lying in the dust. And our Bible verse in Luke chapter 10 shares with us this important insight into the man. It reads like this: but a Samaritan who was on a journey came upon him, and when he saw him, he felt compassion and came to him and bandaged up his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them. He put on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. This Samaritan had knowledge. He had knowledge of dealing with wounds in such a way that he knew how to use wine and knew how to use oil to be able to cleanse and heal the wound. This man put this Jewish man, who was his mortal enemy, religiously, ethnically, culturally, they were considered enemies. Yet this Samaritan experienced, as the Bible, as Jesus told in the story, compassion. The word compassion is actually two Latin words, cum and passion, passion. Cum means with, passion means suffering. Compassion then means with suffering. The Samaritan looked upon this man, and though the man was suffering himself, the Samaritan's heart was pulled from his chest. He was suffering with the man. He saw the man suffering, and it moved him at the gut level. And that compassion moved the Samaritan to action. In fact, he took him and left him at the inn, and he gave money to the innkeeper for at least 2 days worth of taking care of him, lodging, providing the man's needs. And he said, when I come back, I'll even pay more. That's what compassion does. The church has a unique role with education and helping people learn to be compassionate with one another. One of the most challenging things I heard as a pastor and as a believer was in one of my churches in the past. At that church, two men came up to me and they both said to me, "Pastor, we're glad you're here, but we feel like we have more acceptance for who we are and our struggles and people helping us at our small groups at a specialized meeting in the big city nearby than we do in our own church." Friends, church should be the place where people experience the kind of compassion, the quality of compassion, and the enormity of compassion that our God has, because God through Jesus Christ lives in and through us, and his compassion is still alive in this world. The challenge for us is, are we aware that God wants to utilize his compassion in and through us? The church should be the most compassionate place in our society where people can come just as they are, battered, broken, struggling, fearful, wondering what to do next, keep on making mistakes until they see the power of God work in their life day 1, day 10, day 25, day 75, day 365. Whatever it takes, God wants us to live compassionately with others. True Christian education through the local church can help us combine the knowledge that we have learned with the heart of service, can help us combine wisdom and to be able to utilize it with compassion so that we can go out and make a real substantive transformation and difference in the life of our society. True Christian education will move us beyond the pews and into the streets, will move us beyond the couch and into our neighborhood. Today, while I was washing clothes here in our apartment complex, I saw one of those USB cables that is used to charge a cell phone. It was lying next to a car of a couple I knew that lives here in one of the units. And so I figured it was there, so I was able to take that little USB, knock on their door. I was a little nervous, you know, it's the time of COVID, I have my mask on, and I know some people have concerns with people coming to their door, but this guy might have missed his cable. They opened the door, and they saw me there with my mask on, and I simply said, "Hey, I saw this cable near your car, I don't know if it's yours, but I was doing laundry and I saw it. Is it yours?" "Yes, thank you so much for that. Man, I didn't know where it was." Something as simple as being aware of those around us and being aware of the things that are happening and being interested genuinely, compassionately, and courageously interested in people's lives will open up so many possibilities for not just us, but for them as well. God wants to take our true Christian education, the gospel that's not in our heads only, but also in our hearts, and to move out into the community and make a real difference. So to sum up, we need courage to create a safe place so that others can explore their faith. And we need compassion with others to value them as Christ values them, as He has put such a price, such a value, such a worth, because He died in their place and gave everything so that they and I and you can be with Him forever in all eternity. So I pray, church, for us that we will have the courage to take a chance, to let people express themselves, and to grow together, and to be at peace with not having all the answers. And I also pray that we will have the compassion of Christ flow in and through us to make a life-saving impact in the lives of those around us. And to that end, let us pray. God, thank you for sending Christ to live in us. May Christ's courage and His compassion flow through us as a church where people can come and be who they are and to experience their struggle and to know that they will be compassionately loved anyway. Bless us now as we go about our day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his son.